children. I remember seeing the news story. Thank you, Counselor.
All right.
I'm so sorry. I'm gonna have to go tomorrow.
All right, everyone is here. We're on the record in the state of Georgia versus Nydia Pinzón Tisdale, 2015 CR 0556. This is a sentencing hearing. First of all, I'd like for you, I have two more, I'm handling another calendar, so I have two uncontested matters that I need to take care of before we get started. But I need to know from both sides if you have witnesses, how many witnesses, how long you anticipate this to take, because I have some other cases on the calendar that need a hearing, so I need to give them some idea of when to come back. Mr. Greer?
No witnesses, Judge.
And Ms. Bernard, Mr. Harvey?
Judge, I think we have perhaps 10 short witnesses, Judge. When I say short, maybe 10 minutes apiece. So an hour and a half tops, I think, Judge.
Okay, thank you. And we have a matter to deal with, a motion to quash a subpoena. And yes, sir, you are?
Russ Willard with the Attorney General's Office, Your Honor.
All right, I still have the Smith case and the Franklin case, the Burt case, and the Bennett v. Kirby, and the Miller case. If you haven't settled, let's see. I'd say be back at 1 o'clock. If you think that's going to resolve it, you can hold. But I'm not going to hear evidence this morning.
Right.
Okay. Why don't you, I would like to hear the legal question, because then if I get a break, I can start looking at it, okay?
Sure.
All right, let me deal with Smith versus Smith. This is going to take about 15 minutes, folks, on the Tisdale case. If it deals with helping you with a case, then you can use it. Otherwise, you need to step out of the courtroom.
Thank you, Your Honor.
I Yes.
And the final judge of that, please. And would you like us just to come and wait until your other case is done at 1 o'clock, or just come back and...
Just come back and let me know you're here.
Okay, thank you, Heather. Thank you, Your Honor.
Mr. and Ms. Franklin? If you raise your right hand, do you solemnly swear that the testimony you give in this matter will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? And you're Clinton Franklin?
Yes, sir.
And you're Jennifer Franklin?
Yes, sir.
And you all Mr. Franklin, you filed this petition for divorce. And were you a resident of the state of Georgia for at least 6 months immediately prior to filing the complaint?
Yes, sir.
And Ms. Franklin, were you a resident of Dawson County when this was filed?
Yes, ma'am.
You acknowledge service?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, it's signed. Good luck. Lawyers back in the Tisdale matter.
Judge, I'm sorry to interrupt again, but just for order of proceedings.
All right, come on up. I'm sorry.
You want to just take it down? asking for a provision of that.
It's not yours, though.
And if this was his position, I would speak, that's basically a contract issue, it's a spot. You're saying that.
Sure. Wow. At the time, did you drive? How you doing, Craig? Same the last time you saw me.
Taking out spotlight.
Yeah, so it was my dream.
All right, we're back on the record. The State of Georgia versus Nydia Pinzón Tisdale, 2015 CR 0556. This is a sentencing hearing. The jury having found Ms. Tisdale guilty of count two, obstruction of an officer. We have to deal with an issue regarding a motion to quash a subpoena first. And Mr. Willard is here on that, so I'll hear from you, Mr. Willard.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court. Friday afternoon at 1 o'clock, the Office of the Governor was served with a subpoena purporting to compel the governor's attendance at today's hearing. This despite the fact that this hearing had been set for a period of weeks. It's not difficult to find the governor. He may be the easiest person in the state of Georgia to actually perfect service on. Despite all that, the defense counsel served the governor at, as I said, 1 o'clock on Friday afternoon. We filed our motion to quash and close business on Friday, and you asked that we argue it today. We did not have any indication, either the governor's office or our office, what Ms. Tisdale sought to get from the governor's testimony until this morning. They have apparently filed this morning a response to our motion to quash where they made some factual statements. I'm assuming this has now been filed in with the court. I got it about 20 minutes ago. But in talking to Ms. Bernard this morning, as well as seeing their response to the motion in quiet, they apparently want the governor to testify about what he observed at the incident, as well as talk about public comments that he made after the incident. Replowing grounds that a jury had already rendered in this case in terms of the underlying facts. As our brief sets out, Governor Deal does not possess any knowledge of Ms. Tisdale's background that would be unique to this hearing and a determination in the court's evaluation of what sentence to impose on Ms. Tisdale. It is burdensome and oppressive to subpoena the chief executive officer of the state of Georgia to come and testify at a criminal sentencing hearing when his testimony is duplicative and irrelevant. There's nothing the governor could testify to that could not be testified to by a myriad of other witnesses. In addition, the governor has functions as the head of the executive branch of state government that he cannot put aside on a whim or in a last-minute notice that was dilatory in nature. You know, I'm sure the governor's office would have been happy to confer with defense counsel if this had been served within a week of you setting the hearing, but to wait and ambush the governor's staff on Friday afternoon before a Monday morning hearing is irresponsible on the part of the defense and is burdensome on the office of the governor and the people of Georgia. In addition, Your Honor, it was the office of the governor who was served. The office of the governor has no testimony to provide in this matter. They failed to perfect service on Governor Nathan Deal personally, or Nathan Deal individually. As such, there is no compulsory process issued against the actual individual that would compel him to appear and testify in court today. Once again, they served his executive assistant, Rhonda Barnes, with a copy of the subpoena on Friday afternoon. In addition, Your Honor, as we raised in our brief, there is a high burden when senior government officials are served with a subpoena. The courts have been loath to compel their attendance or to compel their testimony absent a high showing, a high burden established by the subpoenaing party that their testimony is somehow unique, that it is essential to the proceedings, and that it cannot be provided in some other form by some other witness. The defense has not made that showing, cannot make that showing, and did not make that showing in their response to the motion to quash. In addition, Your Honor, as I've rephrased, there are serious separation of powers issues by this court providing compulsory process against the office of the governor, the chief executive official of the state of Georgia, to appear at a hearing with such short notice, setting aside all the people's other business to come and testify about something that he is not in a unique position to provide testimony as to. For all those reasons, Your Honor, we would ask that this court quash the subpoena against the governor and also issue a protective order protecting the governor against further attempts to perfect service or to compel his testimony in this case. With nothing further, Your Honor, I'll sit down and would request the court provide me the opportunity to respond to any arguments raised by defense counsel.
All right, first of all, can we folks move over so all these people can sit down, please? I would prefer that you all sit, please. If you're an attorney, you can come over and sit in the jury box.
Thank you.
All right. Mr. Greer, the state also filed a motion to quash. Do you want to be heard any further?
Nothing further to add, Judge.
All right, give me a minute. I've just gotten the response, so let me read that, Ms. Bernard and Ms. Harvey.
Thank you, Your Honor. I think we'll be brief in response. The unique information that Ms. Bernard has just said that they are seeking from the governor is not unique to the governor. There were other individuals who were present. There were other individuals who testified to the courts. But one issue that was raised by Ms. Bernard is essential to this court's consideration, and that is she has repeatedly referred to the fact that the governor was there in his official capacity. And in fact, that is how they served the governor. As this court is aware, that is an issue that trial courts and the appellate courts of this state have struggled with in terms of determining what is an official capacity and what is an individual capacity issue. As far as the courts are concerned, official capacity is not the individual. Official capacity is the officer. It's the office and the state of Georgia itself. There is no individual. There is no person in official capacity. You are there as the state of Georgia. So in effect, when they served Rhonda Barnes with a subpoena on Friday afternoon, They were actually subpoenaing the state of Georgia to testify here today. That is what the governor is in his official capacity. The governor in his official capacity was not at the event at Burt's Pumpkin Farm. The governor in his official capacity has no relevant testimony to provide today. Nathan Deal, in his individual capacity, may very well have information that would, as Ms. Bernard said, be cumulative to other witnesses here. But in terms of how the defense has subpoenaed the office of the governor, there is no relevant testimony that can be obtained. There is no service that is issued against Nathan Deal that would allow him to come and testify today. As such, Your Honor, we would ask that you quash the subpoena and issue a protective order protecting Nathan Deal in his individual and official capacity from any further process in this matter. If the court has no further questions.
Thank you. All right, the motion to quash is granted. I find that the proposed testimony is not material or relevant, and it at best is cumulative. And I also find the subpoena unreasonable, having been given to a member of the governor's staff at the afternoon of last Friday. Let's take a short break. We'll come back and I'll No restraining order. I don't think that's necessary. I'll deal with issues as they come along, but I'm not going to grant this restraining order.
So, Your Honor, I was going to ask if you wanted me to submit a proposed order.
Yes, let's get that in the record.
And, Your Honor, if we could request what we have as Exhibit A is an article detailing the comments that were made by the governor, would the court consider admitting that as evidence, substantive evidence, to be considered in the
What's your position about that, Mr. Greer?
I don't have any objection to that.
That's fine. I'll consider it.
Thank you.
Your Honor, may I approach?
Yes. Go outside, please. Sorry.
If I may approach, I also got a copy of the settlement agreement that would be filed, and the clerk said it wouldn't show up yet, so my apologies, I should print it out. And it gives us the dismissal of the counterclaims, so that also hasn't shown up yet in your file. And the child support addendum language is incorporated in the settlement.
All right. This is the one where the parenting plan is already been signed, right?
Yes, Your Honor, and if I may, if you didn't, I need to do this. I don't check it with my hand, but that's my vision. Detrimental to the child is mediation, and it's also based on the victim.
Main seated, come to order.
Okay, are we waiting for Ms. Bernard?
We are.
Okay.
Let me step outside.
On the record in the state of Georgia versus Nydia Tisdale. I'll hear from the state first.
No evidence presented, Judge.
Would you like to make a... What is the state's position? You want to wait until you hear the evidence?
Judge, typically, yes. I'm used to putting on the evidence and then we go back into recommendations.
All right, that's fine. Mr. Harvey?
Yeah. I guess I'll start then, Judge. What I'd first like to do, if it pleases the court, is present you with defendant's exhibit. I'm going to mark the sentencing exhibits as S1. And they're actually a different color than they were in the trial. Yeah, and that's blue defendant's exhibit system.
That's an email from the Georgia Supreme Court.
Okay. Judge, I would tender, I hope without objection.
No objection.
That would be no objection. An email from the Georgia Supreme Court inviting Ms. Tisdale to be a, on behalf of Justice Navius and Justice Peterson, extending an invitation to attend a meeting scheduled for tomorrow, Tuesday, December 19th, in the Judicial Conference Room located in the Judicial Building at 40 Capitol Square. The meeting will focus on the final version of the proposed Uniform Superior Court Rule 22. So Ms. Tisdale has been extended an invitation by the Georgia Supreme Court to participate in a judicial conference on Rule 22 and journalism and open courtroom proceedings. And I would tender defendant's S1 to Your Honor for perusal.
All right, and that is admitted without objection.
And for inclusion in the record. Judge, I would also retender what has been marked as defendant's 37 in the trial of the case.
metal marking it or remarking it. It's going to have both marks on it. It was not, it did not go out with the jury, so I'm going to mark it as defendant's exhibit number S2. Since I've just admitted S1, which is the invitation by the Georgia Supreme Court to participate in the judicial conference, I'm going to tender S2, which is a picture of Ms. Tisdale with all members of the Georgia Supreme Court after she videoed the proceedings over in Athens of the Georgia Supreme Court, and the justices were kind enough to recognize her, take a picture with Ms. Tisdale in honor of her filming the Georgia Supreme Court proceedings. And I would tender that, and I know the state's already seen that.
No objection.
As state's exhibit number 2. Can I hand that up?
Well, you said state's exhibit.
I mean,
confusing us because it's sentencing to.
Yes, S2.
All right, entered without objection.
All right, thank you.
Your Honor, our first witness will be Brant Meadows. Okay, I apologize, Your Honor. We did have Sam Mullins was going to be our first witness. He is, in fact, stuck in New York because of the airport outage, and Mr. Meadows does have a doctor's appointment. Our next witness will be Jim Bach. Can you please raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Could you please state your name and your occupation?
James Boff. I am currently retired.
And what are you retired from?
Well, I had been county commissioner for 8 years in Forsyth County, and before that I had a career in data networking, primarily optical fiber switching systems.
And how do you know my client, Nydia Tisdale?
When I was a commissioner, I remember that Nydia came forward with some issues on the zoning that had to do with a landfill that might have gone into the county. And she became visible to all commissioners at that time to talk about the problems she had with what appeared to be a zoning going on to some property right next to property that she was associated with.
Was that property she was a property manager of?
I believe that's true, yes.
And so when, do you recall approximately when this was?
I'm going to guess 2010, but I really don't recall clearly.
And since then, have you had any other opportunities to interact with or observe Ms. Tisdale?
Yes. Nydia began to bring her camera to commissioner meetings, in which she filmed the commissioner meetings. And she also brought her camera to other public meetings of a variety of things. It might have been, but I'm not saying specifically was, a new firehouse opening, maybe a new park, but stuff that was publicly oriented in Forsyth County and also in the city of Cumming.
And on these occasions, were you able to, you know, form any opinion of how you viewed Ms. Tisdale's conduct?
Yes. Nydia's conduct has always been excellent. You know, she is how she looks. She's kind of a quiet person, usually conservatively dressed, maybe sometimes fashionably dressed. She would come in when she had her camera, which was almost always. She would set it up quietly, usually before the meeting or the event started, and she would sit and just film. She also has a website that she would put these videos up, and most of the videos are what people seem to refer to as raw video, which is unedited. If there's something that she thought was interesting in the video There might be a note at the bottom that says something like, you know, see Commissioner Boff, mess up this at 2 minutes and 30 seconds into the video, or some kind of a comment like that. But it was generally not opinionated in any way other than here's a highlight or here's what I think is interesting.
And are you aware of her general reputation for truthfulness and honesty?
Yes, you know, she has a reputation of trying to get government and government activity as transparent and available to the public as possible. In fact, she would frequently, in addition to doing the camera work, hand out things like this. Sometimes it was the Constitution, but this is something that I received from her at some time. It's the Citizen's Guide to Open Government, Office of the Georgia Attorney General Sam Owens, which she handed out innumerable times to people who just might be filing into a building or a room as they passed by, if they wanted one.
And did you ever observe her being disruptive or doing anything that you, as a commissioner or in your private capacity, believed to be a threat to public safety?
Never.
And do you have any opinion regarding Ms. Tisdale's contributions to the community, Forsyth County and beyond?
Yes, I think her contributions have been tremendous. Tremendously good for everyone. First of all, she's got innumerable videos of significant public events, but that are common, largely common public events that people might not have the time or interest to attend. And she also would frequently, if there was something in the video that was unusual, she would actually frequently get a document. It might be a state law that says thus and such is, you know, illegal, or thus and such is proper, or she might have produce a deed from someplace for somebody's zoning that would say, you know, this deed is shows that this property has some problems with it in terms of being zoned, perhaps the way that the current zoning is being requested to happen.
And so did you, based on what you just told us about her going through zoning regulations, did that also provide a public service in your view?
Yes, and you know, the general service that I saw was that Nydia was always non-disruptive. She always brought her, almost always brought her camera. She handed out information that the public should know, that politicians should know, assuming you value transparency in government. And then her website with the videos. Actually, one day I told her that I thought she should call them Nidios instead of videos, which she does. So I thought they were, but even if they were not helpful, the fact is that she has an absolute right to be videoing the type of stuff that she videos.
And Mr. Boff, as you're aware, we're of course here for a sentencing where Judge Christian will make a determination. Do you have any opinion about what sentence you believe the judge should give to the
court? I'm going to object to that, Judge. That's purely up to you.
And of course it is, and I'm only asking if he has any opinion on it.
Objection is sustained.
Certainly. Do you believe that there would be any, do you believe that Nydia poses any danger to the community?
None.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bob. No further questions. The Assistant District Attorney may have.
Mr. Greer.
Do you know Johnny or Kathy Burt, Mr. Bob?
No, I don't.
You ever been on their property?
I think years ago I lived in Dawson County when my daughter was small, and I think we visited the pumpkin farm then, but that would have been probably more than 20 years ago.
Okay, thank you. No further questions.
And nothing further, Your Honor.
Your Honor, may I ask a helpful ADA question?
No, sir, you may not.
Thank you.
Our next witness will be Jeff Johnson, Your Honor.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Your Honor. Could you please raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you for your kind comments. And could you please tell us your name and occupation, sir?
Jeff Johnson, Sheriff of Dawson County.
And how do you know my client, Nydia Tisdale?
I've become acquainted with Ms. Tisdale two and a half years ago through the debates and through the election process.
And when you say the debates and election process, are those debates and elections that you were participating in?
Correct. Yes, ma'am.
And so how many times would you say you had an opportunity to observe Ms. Tisdale conducting herself?
I'd say at least four.
And have you ever had any personal interactions or conversations with Ms. Tisdale?
Yes, ma'am.
And as a and were you participating in any swearing-in ceremonies where she was videotaping?
I don't recall if she was at the swearing-in testimony or not, ma'am.
Okay. Or any election night parties, anything like that?
Correct. She was, yes, ma'am.
Okay. And have you ever did you ever observe her being disruptive in any way?
She was not.
Did you observe her doing anything that you believe would be a threat to public safety?
No, ma'am.
Do you have any opinion about her contributions to the community through what she does?
Well, I did hear out while I was on the campaign trail personally of people talking about referencing and watching videos online, debate videos, things of that nature. I didn't ask them where they got it from, but I assume they got it from online somewhere.
So did you find that having someone videotape debates and other political events that you participated in was helpful in getting the message out to voters in Dawson County?
I did.
And do you, is there anything about Ms. Tisdale, and do you have any, I apologize. Do you have any opinion about Ms. Tisdale's overall contributions to the community in North Georgia?
Well, again, speaking from my experience, I believe that if that was the information from obtained from Ms. Nydia's videos, people did watch them and did comment to me on just overall, you know, overall assessment of the debates, things of that nature.
And thank you very much, Sheriff Johnson. That's all our questions.
Thank you.
Mr. Greer.
Good morning, Sheriff.
Good morning.
How many deputies do you currently supervise?
Sworn deputies, roughly about 65.
Now, did you know Tony Wooden?
Yes, sir, I did.
How long have you known Tony?
2004. No, probably before that, but at least 2004.
You knew, what, do you have any opinion about folks that obstruct your officers when they're trying to just do their job?
I'm sorry, would you rephrase, repeat?
Do you have any opinion about people that obstruct officers when they're just trying to do their job?
Well, I think it's, do I have an opinion on it?
Yeah, I'm not asking for anything more specifically, but about people that obstruct law enforcement officers. Do you think folks should generally follow law enforcement officers'
Absolutely.
Guidelines?
Yes.
That's where I'm getting at.
Yes, sir.
All right, no further questions. Thank you.
Orders that were given in this case with Nydia Tisdale?
The orders, ma'am?
That were given to Ms. Nydia Tisdale? And if you don't, that's perfect.
Are you referring to the officer's orders to Ms. Tisdale?
Yes.
I'm not familiar enough to comment on it, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Sheriff. Nothing further. And we don't have any further questions.
Nothing to say, Judge.
You may step down.
Thank you.
Your Honor, our next witness will be Richard Griffin. Good morning, Mr. Griffin. Can you please raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you. Could you please state your name for the court and your occupation?
Richard Griffiths. I retired in March from CNN. I have been working at the Grady College of the University of Georgia as the Cox Distinguished Visiting Professional, and at the University of North Carolina School of Media and Journalism as the Stembler Visiting Professional.
And what was your role at CNN that you retired from?
For the last 20 years, I was in charge of global editorial oversight. I was the guy who got gray hair from dealing with all our reporters worldwide and in the United States.
And how long did you work in journalism?
43 years until I retired.
And do you hold any offices in any nonprofit organizations?
I do. I have just been elected president of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. My term begins January 1st.
And in that role, have you been familiar, have you had the opportunity to become familiar with Nydia Tisdale?
Yes, I have. In 2015, we at the Georgia First Amendment Foundation gave Ms. Tisdale the First Amendment and Open Government Hero Award for her work in open government, the body of her work, and her tenacious approach to open government.
And now, were you a participant in the decision-making process that selected Ms. Tisdale for this honor?
I was not at that time. I was a member of the First Amendment Foundation, but I didn't become a board member until a year and a half ago, two years ago, right after the award. I was at the event, however, when the award was given.
Okay. And is this the award was given?
Yes, it's a lovely award.
And I'm going to show you what's been marked as Defense Sentencing Exhibit 2. Three. Do you recognize?
Yes, that is our current president, Sean McIntosh, and Ms. Tisdale receiving the award.
Thank you. And Your Honor, at this time we will submit Defense Sentencing 3. I apologize, I misspoke earlier.
Any objection?
No objection, Judge.
Entered without objection.
And so, Mr. Griffiths, have you had the opportunity to personally interact with Ms. Tisdale?
I have, actually. She has recorded, I think, about 5 events where I've either been present or a panelist where I have been presenting. Each of those events, Ms. Tisdale has come in and set up her camera and tripod openly but quietly. She's not hidden herself in the room in some way to secretly record, but openly set up her recording device. Been very polite. Process went well. Sometimes she came up afterwards and asked me for information, a bio. She did in one particular event where I was making a presentation to the American Constitution Society, and that was posted along with the video later. She's also been at several First Amendment open government forums that the First Amendment Foundation sponsored, where she videotaped those events. I've also seen her, I believe, at the Georgia Bar Media Judiciary Conference, where she taped some of those events.
And have you ever observed her being disruptive in any way at any of these events?
No, not at all. Very professional.
Have you ever observed her in any way being a threat to public safety?
No.
And do you have any opinion on the value of her contributions to the community and the work that she...
I fully support the Georgia First Amendment Foundation's decision to give her that award. What she does for open government is vital for our democracy, and the body of work speaks for itself. She has done an extraordinary thing in providing a huge collection of public videos of public meetings and public events for others to go back to and refer to be able to use as a resource, not only now, but perhaps for future generations for North Georgia.
And I don't have any further questions at this time. The Assistant District Attorney may have a few for you.
No questions, Judge.
You may step down.
Thank you.
Just let me follow that up with the tender of defendant sentencing exhibit number 4. I've shown this to the state, and the state said that they have no objection to that. Since the previous witness testified about the body of work, this article indicates that, at least as of the date that the article was published, vital statistics with regard to that body of work that Ms. Tisdale has is, there are 850 videos posted on Ms. Tisdale's website, all public events, all unedited and unexpurgated and available for the public viewing. There are over 250,000 times her videos have been viewed. And so I want to make sure that the record reflects that body of work that was just testified about, those statistics are also in the record. State's Exhibit 4 also contains some continued personal history, as already testified by Ms. Tisdale during the trial of the case. So I submit to you defendant's sentencing exhibit number 4. I keep looking at the S and thinking it's state.
Yeah,
and Judge, I use this for you.
Any objection?
No objection.
Give it without objection.
Also, I'm going to remark what was marked as defendant's exhibit number 35 for the record, but not admitted as defendant's sentencing exhibit number 5. Defendant's exhibit S3, and this has already been admitted, so should I hand it up to you?
Yeah.
Defendant's exhibit number S5 is Ms. Tisdale being awarded Georgia Common Cause Democracy Award 2014 as Nydia Tisdale Citizen Journalist. This is the award ceremony for when she received that award, given for her commitment to improving our democracy. The award is pictured in defendant's sentencing exhibit number 5, and this is physically the exhibit which we won't tender in evidence.
Any objections to file?
No objection.
Entered without objection.
I'm going to hand that up as well. Thank you.
Our next witness will be Bill Finch. Good morning, Mr. Finch. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you. And if you could please state your name and occupation.
William Finch. I'm the Solicitor General for Forsyth County.
And Ms. French, how are you acquainted with my client, Nydia Tisdale?
I met her when I was on the campaign trail.
Okay. What campaign trail was that?
For Solicitor General in Forsyth County.
And were you able to observe her at any events in Forsyth County?
I was.
Were you able to observe her video recording at any events?
I did.
And do you have any opinion about whether or not anything she was doing was disruptive or a threat to public safety?
Yes, and it was not.
And did you ever observe her doing anything that was disruptive or, in your view, a threat to public safety?
I did not.
And at any point, did you speak directly to Ms. Tisdale about the work that she did?
Yes, I did, on a number of occasions.
And do you have any opinion about her reputation for truthfulness and honesty in the community?
To the extent that the videos that she would post would be, for the most part, unedited and without editorial comment. And so for truthfulness, she was putting out what it was that candidates said, and so that citizens would be able to observe it by watching a video.
And do you believe that she provided a public service by doing these activities?
Absolutely. As a candidate, I valued it. We would raise money to get out our message. And when we raised money to get out our message, there would be times where 30 or 40 people in a county of over 200,000 would show up. And when Ms. Tisdale would videotape it and put it online for our electorate to view, it helped us as candidates.
So in your view, has Ms. Tisdale made contributions to the community in Forsyth County and elsewhere?
Absolutely.
No further questions at this time. Thank you very much, Mr. Finch.
No questions.
You may step down.
Thank you.
And I have a calendar at 1. May I be relieved of my subpoena?
He may be excused from us.
Any objections, Mr. Greer?
No objection.
You are relieved and excused.
Thank you.
Next witness is David Milam, Your Honor. Good morning. Please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you. Could you please have a seat and tell us your name and occupation?
James David Milam. I'm semi-retired. I work with the Georgia Department of Transportation. I'm one of their handful of certified appraisers for improvements on like road widening and things like that. So I've been doing that for about 33 years.
And how did you become acquainted with my client, Nydia Tisdale?
Nydia purchased a website that she presently owns, aboutforsyth.com. I was into politics. Politics, that's what my wife, she's from Columbia, calls it. And politics for, I guess, about 20 years, something like that. And I bought a website from a guy in Gwinnett County, and which a little later, I think somewhere around 2009, I guess it was, Nydia purchased the website. I'm not sure of that date.
And how did you decide to sell your website to Ms. Tisdale?
I was tired. It was a lot of work. There's a lot goes on in the political world, and it would just really always was more than I could handle. I admire Nydia to do what she does. It is a tireless, tireless job.
Well, and do you have any opinion on what Nydia has done with the website and her videos since purchasing it from you?
It's excelled. It's very professional. I try to be professional, but that's just it. I tried. The media was successful. And it's a wonderful website. It's well laid out. People can go there. If they're curious about a candidate, they can go, and it's got an index and a search feature. You can find out anything you want to about any politician in North Georgia. She'll go have a video. She's got lots of them.
And have you had the opportunity to observe Ms. Tisdale actually making these recordings at any events?
Many, scores and scores of occasions.
Okay. And how, what was your opinion of how she conducted herself at those events?
She was quiet as a little mouse, and get in the corner and you didn't hear one peep out of her. Matter of fact, she's one of the most cordial, sweet, intelligent, and professional people that I know. I've never met anybody more so than Nydia Tisdale.
And do you have any opinion about her contributions to the community in Forsyth and elsewhere?
Invaluable, invaluable. If you want to, like I say, if you want to know something about the political scene in Forsyth County or Dawson County or the State House, go to aboutforsyth.com and you'll get your answer.
Thank you so much. No further questions at this time, Mr. Thanks.
No questions, Jeff.
You may step down.
We have Stuart T. Can you please raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you. Could you please state your name and occupation for the court?
I'm Stuart Teague. I'm an attorney.
And where do you practice?
I practice primarily in Cumming.
And do you know my client, Nydia Tisdale?
I do. I've known Nydia for probably 10 years now or so.
How did you first become acquainted with Ms. Tisdale?
I think the first time dealt with a zoning issue down in Roswell on the Chattahoochee River. And then I think subsequently she was involved as a property manager for a limited partnership that owns property on Ronald Reagan Boulevard in Forsyth County.
And do you have any, when you were interacting with her on these matters, how was she conducting herself?
She's always been professional, very courteous, very studious in how she goes about doing what she does in connection with the activities she's been engaged with on properties.
And do you, have you ever observed her being disruptive or doing anything that you would consider a threat to public safety?
No.
And what's your opinion about her contributions to the community in Forsyth and anywhere else?
I think she does valuable service by providing the video services. She covers public hearings and meetings that would otherwise sometimes escape media scrutiny.
I don't think we have any further questions. Thank you very much, Mr. Chief.
Thank you.
The Assistant District Attorney may have.
No question.
You may step down.
May I have to excuse
that? Any objections?
Not at all, Your Honor.
None.
You are excused. Can you please raise your right hand?
Yes.
Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you. Could you please state your name and occupation for the court?
Okay, my name is Garland Favorito. I'm a retired career IT professional, and I'm the co-founder of Voter GA, which stands for Voters Organized for Trusted Election Results in Georgia.
And when did you first meet my client, Nydia Tisdale?
I met Nydia about 7 years ago.
And what was the occasion?
We had launched a project, and in addition to elections projects, we also do other freedom and liberty projects. And we launched a project called the Free Georgia 400 Project.
and that was to remove the Georgia 400 toll, not because we opposed toll so much, but it's because the city and the state of Georgia had not honored its agreement with the city of Atlanta. Nydia was the first videographer to begin that recording us and getting the issue out for the public to see.
And have you, since then, had the opportunity to observe Ms. Tisdale videoing any other events?
Absolutely. She's done at least half a dozen of our events, and with most of which were me personally. And then I've been at a variety of other events in which she has recorded, so I would say at least over a dozen events total, which she's recorded and put up on her website.
And have you ever observed her do anything that you would consider disruptive or a threat to public safety?
Absolutely not. It's almost a laughable question.
Well, have you ever observed her doing anything that you think is not contributing to the community, that is a detriment to the community?
No, not at all. I mean, what she does is, I think others have already testified, is she gets attention on issues that will normally escape the media. And she does that in a way that's unbiased. She puts her videos up, which were unfiltered. And they are videos that you can't get anywhere else. So that's why it's a tremendous public service.
And are you aware of her reputation for truthfulness and honesty?
It's impeccable.
Do you have any opinions as the leader of your voting rights organization about the value that she has brought with her video work?
Well, just to give you the example in the Georgia 400 situation, I have to give her a lot of credit for the removal of the Georgia 400 toll, because the project was very, very successful. It happened very quickly, but it was Nydia Tisdale who put the first videos up to get that issue out to the public.
So do you believe her work has been valuable to you as a Georgia citizen working on these issues?
Not just to me as a Georgia citizen, but to the community in general, the journal activist community, the watchdog community, as well as the general public. It's absolutely invaluable.
Thank you so much, Mr. Fabrito. No further questions.
No questions, thank you.
You may step down.
And then we also have Mr. Fang Zhao. Good morning. Can you please raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you. Could you please state your name and occupation for the court?
Sure. My name is Fangjo. I'm an associate professor at the University System of Georgia.
Okay. And how did you first meet my client, Nydia Tisdale?
Well, I met Ms. Tisdale in October at a Michael Williams gubernatorial candidate for governor event in Roswell. And this is where she shared with me and others about what had happened to her. And I had seen many videos of Ms. Tisdale posted on YouTube before. So we talked, I gave her my contact information, and then I told her that I want to support her in this situation.
Well, and do you work in politics at all?
Yes, I work for Congresswoman Karen Handel's Asian Voter Outreach, and in 2017 she won a special election against John Ossoff in Georgia District 6, where I live.
And in that capacity, have you on Congresswoman Handel's campaign, have you had any opportunity to use Ms. Tisdale's video materials?
Absolutely, and they are absolutely invaluable. So for many Asian voters, particularly many of them who are first-time voters who want to watch all 18 of the candidates debate, I was able to show them Ms. Tisdale's video from the Cobb County Chamber of Commerce, where all 18 candidates had a chance to debate. So for many voters, especially first-time voters, I was able to show them the unbiased, objective, and transparent, unfiltered videos that Ms. Tisdale had posted on YouTube.
And so what is your opinion of the value of Ms. Tisdale's contributions to the political community here in Georgia?
Well, I'm very grateful personally because she posted a lot of not only candidate debates, but city council meetings across several different counties on YouTube. And for me to be able to talk to voters, many of them first-time voters, to be able to show them where they could find candidate debates, so forth, those are extremely, extremely valuable.
And thank you so much. Actually, one further question. Have you ever observed Ms. Tisdale being disruptive or doing anything to threaten public safety at any events?
Absolutely not. When I met Ms. Tisdale at Michael Williams as governor, for governor event, she didn't bring a recorder. She just sat there, but she wanted to share with me and others about her traumatic experience that she had.
No further questions at this time. Thank you very much.
No questions.
You may step down.
Thank you, ma'am. Can you please raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you. You have a seat. Could you please state your name and occupation for the court?
Sure. It's Mike Pachinik. I'm a reporter for WSB-TV in Atlanta.
I apologize for the pronunciation, Mr. Pachinik.
No problem.
And, of course, as a journalist, you must remain objective about these kinds of proceedings, correct?
Absolutely.
We did want to ask, have you ever used any of Nydia Tisdale's videos in your reporting?
Yes, we have.
Okay. Do you has that been valuable to you as a news reporter?
Sure. There are times when we can't get a camera to an event, so Nydia has been kind enough to share her videos with us to use, and credit to her.
Okay. Has she ever demanded payment or withheld the videos?
Never.
Have you ever been concerned that the videos were taken out of context or misrepresented in some way?
Never.
Do you have an opinion as to the trustworthiness and reliability and honesty of Ms. Tisdale?
I never had any question about it.
Thank you very much. No further questions.
No questions.
You may step down.
Judge, I've got three other exhibits I'd like to tend to the court for this time. Could you, Mr. Court Reporter, tell me, or Your Honor, tell me what number of four?
Yes.
Six.
Six. Seven. Yes, eight. And I have shown these as part of the same article.
Same thing. Okay.
Just tender my own pictures.
I knew you would do that, okay.
Judge, I'm going to tender SS6, which is an AJC. Article regarding this particular matter, and I think it without objection, so I tender S6. It's in, and this contains, importantly, I think, quotations from one of the witnesses that appeared at the trial of the case. That's Mr. Bearden. Mr. Bearden, for public comment, indicated, and I'll reiterate, what he testified at trial also. Mr. Burt could care less about people filming, Bearden told me. Outside of the request from GOP staffers, I don't think he'd care at all. Bearden says he regrets the whole affair. He said it has soured him on politics ever since. It would have been nice if people had taken a moment to find out who she is. I don't think anybody has a problem or should have a problem with people videotaping political events. That's S6, and that's tendered.
for the record.
You have no objection, Mr. Greer?
No objection, yes.
Entered without objection.
S7, and I've got your stapler, Judge. Just in case you think I'm going to ask about it. Watch carefully. S7, I'm the tender S7. I've shown it to the state previously. Admitted without...
No objection, Judge.
Entered without objection.
Again, I want to reiterate, it may also be in evidence from another source as far as the quotes from the governor. S7 contains the public commentary by the governor of the state of Georgia. The governor said Tisdale's ouster made him feel uncomfortable. He said, and I quote, "I think all of you know I'm not reluctant to have people video me under any circumstances," Deal said. "If I were, I wouldn't be talking to you today." So I'll tender number S7. And finally, defendant sentencing exhibit number 8, which I had shown the state earlier. It's an article from the, and I would consider it one of the most prestigious journals in the country. It is the Columbia Journalism Review, an article about Ms. Tisdale entitled "How One Woman's Hyperlocal C-SPAN Brings Transparency to Politics in Georgia." Columbia Journalism School and Columbia Journalism Review is the top journalism peer-reviewed publication in the United States of America. I tender defendant's sentencing exhibit number 8.
Any objection?
No objection.
Entered without objection.
And I think that's all that we have at this point. Judge, I think that Ms. Tisdale has the option to allocute to the court. I don't know whether she wants to take that opportunity, but would this be the time, since that's the last evidence we have other than her allocution, would this be the appropriate time if she wishes to make a statement to the court?
Let me deal with something first. You handed me earlier, Mr. Harvey, an envelope that had, or a folder that had the number of letters in it. Do you want to make those part of the record? Have you seen those, Mr. Greer?
I have, Judge, and I have no objection in tendering them.
All right, well, then I would just ask that this folder be marked as 9.
That's fine.
Defendant's S9.
Do you want me to do a sticker?
I'll ask the court reporter to do that in a minute. And those are entered without objection.
Yes, ma'am.
Ms. Tisdale, you have a right to make a statement to the court if you wish to do so. You do not have to, and if you decide to remain silent, I would not hold that against you in any way. Do you understand that?
Yes, Your Honor.
All right. Would you like to make a statement?
Yes, I
would. Go ahead. She sit down at the witness stand.
Okay,
I think that's.
I'm sorry, I thought that was too clear.
Your Honor, may I remove the phone cuffs from behind Mrs. Hill's head?
No.
Do
Thank you, Your Honor, for this opportunity to speak. I'd like to introduce my parents, Wesley and Leonore Doggett. My father had an old movie camera, and the first thing that he ever filmed was my christening, my baptism. And I grew up with a camera in my family, in my house. We would always make video records and photographs of all of our events, birthdays and graduations and reunions and just happy occasions, because we would like to remember those happy occasions. And my father has since passed away. And 4 years ago when he died, his funeral was in the same church that I was baptized in, and I actually video recorded his funeral 50 years later. And so a camera has just been a natural part of my life and my family's life. And if there's an important event, it's nice to have a video record of that event. And I like to share that. And I was the family historian, if you will, by documenting our gatherings with my camera and my video camera. And that was a natural progression into my citizen journalism. When I first started traveling as a child, my parents gave me a diary and told me to write down everything I did every day, and gave me a camera and told me to take pictures of where I had been. And so that was the birth of my citizen journalism when I was 11 years old and took my first plane flight. My mother is, excuse me, my mother is 90 years old. And she's entering hospice care this week. And she's not expected to make it till the end of this year. She had a surgery just a few days before my trial, and I was unable to visit her during that time. I very much would like to go and see my mother and be with her before she passes. She has Alzheimer's and she doesn't really remember us much anymore, but she smiles and she's still very loving, and I just need to go and say goodbye to her. When I heard about this event at Burt's Pumpkin Farm back in August of 2014, I learned about it just the day before, and I saw it on Facebook in my newsfeed. And I looked at the website for Burt's Farm, and I actually posted the event on Twitter and on Facebook at all of the candidates' campaign Facebook pages to encourage attendance. And when I first noticed the event, there were maybe about 20 people that had marked going, and then the morning of the event there were 60 people that were going, and so I think my efforts helped to improve attendance. And it's not often that you get all of our state officials together at one time, and I thought it was a pretty special and important event, and I just wanted to document that so that they would have a record of it. And I had filmed most of these candidates previously. I had filmed them in my city of Roswell just 3 weeks earlier, and I met Governor Deal. I had met him multiple times previously, actually, when he was a congressman and he was running for governor the first time. And I shook his hand, and I actually have a video of shaking his hand. And there was a person that I learned later was what they call a Democratic tracker. I had not encountered that, and was unfamiliar with that term, but Governor Deal greeted him and shook his hand, and he said, I hope my people are treating you well. And I'm paraphrasing, it's on video, you can confirm that quote. But he was very respectful, and I've enjoyed video recording him at various functions, including the state Republican Party convention three different times.
And so I meant no harm by coming to this campaign event that was advertised as open to the public. And I had filmed everyone, and I basically was announcing myself by tagging them on social media, and most of the candidates expected me to be there. So it was most unfortunate that this event happened as it did. I can't fully understand it, because the candidates are usually very grateful and appreciative of my video, and I help them to get their messages out in their own words as they choose to present themselves. And in fact, at the Roswell rally, Governor Deal and U.S. Senate candidate Perdue encouraged everyone there to get the word out. Tell your friends, tell your neighbors, tell people at church and at work that we've got an election. It's an important election. You need to go to the ballot box and cast your vote. I don't endorse particular candidates. I can't afford to donate money to anyone, but I'm a citizen advocate for the electorate, for the voters, and I want the voters to know that there's an election going on and what their choices are. And as Fang mentioned earlier, I filmed all 18 candidates in my district for district number 6, and it was fascinating. And oftentimes I'm undecided on how to cast my ballot, and so I'm learning by filming this, and I just want to share it with other voters so they can make an educated decision when they cast their ballot. So I'm sorry this has happened. I don't think the Burt's meant any harm. I don't fully understand all of the events that transpired that day, and maybe I never will, but it's a real crying shame, because it would have been a really beautiful video and a historic video that would have highlighted this wonderful tourist attraction, the Burt's Farm, their business. So I asked the court now today at my sentencing hearing for leniency. And when I was arrested, I spent about 8 hours in the county detention center in jail. And it was a Saturday night. It was late when I got out, after midnight, and so if the court, if Your Honor, would consider possibly a sentence of time served, because I actually was incarcerated while waiting to be booked and bonded, I would greatly appreciate that. And I would also like to take this opportunity, if it's appropriate, to thank Your Honor for not holding court on Saturday, and also to thank Your Honor for allowing me a fortnight to prepare my witnesses and all of our exhibits for today's sentencing hearing. I also want to thank the jury for all of their time and for finding me not guilty of 2 of the 3 charges. And I'd like to thank my counsel and all of my supporters and everyone who has come and spoken on my behalf today. And that is my statement. Thank you. Oh, I forgot one thing, if I may add. My father was a physics professor at North Carolina State University, and in October, he was inducted into the Electrical and Computer Engineering Hall of Fame at North Carolina State University posthumously, and I was there for that event, and I video recorded that event, and it's just nice that they have recognized his contributions to society. He was very well respected and admired, and his work has been memorialized in books, and I'm almost grateful that all of this happened after he passed away, because I think it would have disrupted him or caused him great consternation, and I'm almost grateful that my mother has Alzheimer's and isn't aware of anything that's happened with me in the last 3 years. Thank you.
Judge, thank you.
All right, I want to read all of this before I hear your argument, so give me about 15, well, let's say 20 minutes. And we'll come back and I'll hear from you again.
Is anybody getting Nydia, and can you get a picture of them? This is really special, Richard. For us.
So where did you end up?
Well,
So where did you end up?
She wasn't lying.
She's
not lying.
Thank you.
Deb? Mike Pachena, good to see you in person. What's up, man? How are you? Yeah, it wasn't planning on that. Yeah, that was surprising. Yeah, that's fine. As long as I wasn't asked any questions that would be out of bounds. Who's that? Oh, okay. Yeah, that's a little surprising, Andy. Thanks for that curve. Yeah, well, I appreciate them keeping it, you know, objective question.
Richard Griffiths, good to see you.
Can we speak to you afterwards?
Yeah, sure. No, hang on. I was going to flee, but
oh, okay.
But I'm happy to.
Thank you.
Good job, buddy.
Thanks, Mike. Of course. This is the reason to be right here. This is the finale.
After what? 3 years, 4 months? Almost 3 years of full time.
October. Or it was August.
August 23rd.
Go slow.
Before lunch, or before lunch?
I hope so.
I think I'll stay after.
Can they hedge the two?
I still cross. What's your reason?
And I should just say we're all. They're all standing.
He was trying to impression.
There you go.
To the audience that has.
There you go. That's exactly what happened.
I'm sorry. What's your name? Ralph Garnett.
Doug Davis.
I got your name and I'll look for you and I'll work. I mean, like I say, I leave a lot of carefully crafted commentaries. They brought them, as you know, as his main office in Blue Ridge, right next to the Chamber of Commerce.
Thank you. Be seated.
Please, the court. There has been a lot of testimony today mentioning an interesting word, democracy, and what that means. And there's been a lot of talk in these letters, some all very passionate, John, speaking of important work that the defendant does. In this case, it relates to First Amendment rights. And there is no doubt, based on the witnesses that you've heard, that there is some benefit, depending on who you are, political candidate. These two said they derive some benefit. I believe Sheriff Johnson said, he ever heard someone saw a video, must have been before, from his Tisdale website. But what good is the public good if the laws don't apply to all of us? This is not a First Amendment case. It is not at all. I find that seems to be the blurred line, as it were. I don't believe there's anyone in here right now that doesn't agree in the First Amendment. The freedom of the press. It doesn't agree that the defendant should have a right in the public forum to film. She follows the rules set forward in that form. The law supports her in doing that. I don't think there is anyone who would disagree that an open and transparent government is something that the citizens not only should have access to, but they should do it. But again, that's not an issue in this case. Had this been a rally, it wouldn't be called a rally, mind you, or I'm about to tell you, but had this been a rally in this building, it's a public building, had it been at the Dawsonville Municipal Center, again, it's on public property. But for whatever reason, this rally was chosen to be on a private piece of land. A pumpkin farm. There were going to be no real minutes of government issue. This was just a stump speech anyway.
getting your message out, like you heard Solicitor Trent say, which I guess can help for a candidate, as long as the candidate remembers who they are they're representing when they're elected. But nonetheless, all these concepts are absolutely worthless without the rule of law. Without the rule of law. I heard words like tenacious to describe the defendant's commitment to the First Amendment. Now, that is lawful, but even the First Amendment, even in public areas, free speech, there are certain limitations, but that's not even an issue. This wasn't a public area. Words like activists and watchdog, again, very important. It's scary to think of an unchecked government. So these types of organizations serve a vital role. But again, that's not an issue, because this was on a private piece of property in Dawson County. Someone had opened up their property to the public for this type of event. Now, should they have changed their minds at any time about who could speak or what they could speak to? It could have been a bad decision, a good decision, one I disagree with, one you disagree with, but they could have changed their minds for any reason that they wanted to. And if the law doesn't protect them the same, their laws mean nothing. And they could have thrown who they wanted off their property for any reason. And we all might have disagreed and said this was a bad thing or this was a good thing, but they had the right to do that. Now, Judge, you sat as a 13th jury. You heard all these witnesses. You heard all the evidence. You made your own determinations about what went on. You have the article that Mr. Derrida says he regrets the decision, they didn't spend more time, but you also learned at the trial that there was an effort to find out who the defendant was, but Commissioner Butler didn't pause. He went on speaking before they could address the issue. You heard all of that. You heard what Mr. Hutchins said versus what Mr. Beardon said. And you know all the things that Tony Wooten knew when he went and approached this defendant. Heard of the, what I would say, reasonable efforts, just to have the defendant stop filming before we get to the issue of removing, stopping filming at least two persons prior to Captain Wooten approach. Now, we can all disagree on what's reasonable behavior or not reasonable, or if she should have had to stop filming or not stop filming, but they admit pretty clear that the owners had requested, for whatever reason, they stopped doing. Now, in Sentence Exhibit 7, since you have the article from the ADC, where Governor Bill does say that it was kind of unsettling, but he, interestingly enough, the governor, as governors do, referred that decision back to the property owners. Be it a good or bad one, that was their decision. So, it all then boils down to the very thing that we're here for today. You've heard opinion testimony that the defendant is trustworthy based on the experiences of watching her film and various other venues, where nothing that you heard over the trial of 6 days occurred. But the jury sat here and heard conflicting testimony between her and Tony Wooten. They made their own determinations of who to believe. Verdict of guilty, and she obstructed a law enforcement officer, specifically that he was acting as an authorized representative of Mr. Burt. And for her not leaving, she was asked to leave. So, as you ponder these things, what right does anyone have to break the law in the name of another law? Because that's really what this is. The First Amendment doesn't trump any other amendment.
The laws were written to protect and for the good of all of us. And if we don't have to follow the rule of law, then you name another law. But that's not a democracy. That's something completely different that I want to impart. Because then it becomes arbitrary. The defendant's response, I would submit, is not reasonable. This could have been avoided. This was not reasonable. She conceded at trial. She was warned the deputy was going to come over and ask her to leave. If she simply wasn't going to stop coming. And that wasn't her land. And that wasn't the public's land. You were Captain Wynn. He didn't know her from the fight. She made a conscious choice. The jury determined that he was a police officer. And that anybody else would have known he was a police officer. Two speakers knew he was a police officer. And she ought to be held accountable for that. That being said, the state is not trying to minimize. She has done good work. We agree to that. She has done good work. And we hope she continues to do good work. But she ought to be held accountable. Because the decision she made, consciously, I submit, she knew exactly what she was doing. She refused to stop doing it. She knew that Tony Wooten was a police officer. And there are consequences. There ought to be consequences. That being said, the state would recommend a 12-month probationary sentence in this count to no addition to time in jail. That would not serve any purpose, I do not think. However, she'd pay a $1,000 fine for cost surcharges. Conditions that she report to Mr. New Probation. Ms. Tisdale performed 40 hours of community service. For the charity approved by the probation officer. And that she had no contact with Mr. Luke. That she would sign a record release if she gets put on probation. The probation officer can check on prescriptions, avoid alcohol and drugs while she's on probation, verify prescriptions. And I earnestly believe she should be required to write a letter of apology to Tony Wooten.
All right, did I hear that again? You're going to ask to leave?
And the reason. And there's a reason. And I knew that would draw that type of response. It seems to be lost in all this. That's what I was saying. We're a nation governed by laws, state governed by law. And whether we agree with them or we don't, there's a right way and a wrong way. And you would think that folks that are entrenched with First Amendment values would understand the right way and the wrong way. But when we start respecting law enforcement officers, there is no hope for us.
We are here, contrary to Mr. Greer's belief, in a court of law. The law applies equally to those who are bound to enforce it as to those citizens who are bound by the laws as well. I am not here, and we are not here, to retry this case. You did hear it. You heard the evidence, and a jury rendered a verdict. But there are requirements of the law that law enforcement officers have to comply with. And a jury heard Tony Wooten testify. And a jury heard Tony Wooten testify about what he may have said to Ms. Tisdale. And a jury heard about any injuries Mr. Wooten may have received, and they rejected that They said, no, she is not guilty of that. So we're bound by those rules and those rules of law as well. And I beg to differ with the state as to whether or not this case, in what has happened to Nydia Tisdale, does not implicate some of our fundamental principles. Getting information about public officials in a form that can be disseminated readily to the population at large is a core principle of the First Amendment, and we have an interest in protecting and promoting the free exercise of government affairs, and there is nothing more at the core of those values than a publicly advertised political rally at which an entire slate of statewide officials are going to tell the public what they have to say and what they're going to do for the people here and why they're going to do it and how they're going to do it and who better than a nonpartisan person who quietly and unobtrusively films those public officials and then disseminates it to the public. Who better to do that, and what is more fundamental to our core values than that? I submit to you that you have heard about her, because now is the time, and I think it's the most difficult function a judge has to encounter. What, Judge Christian, do we do with this person who appears before you? What do we do with this human being who who doesn't have the resources, who doesn't have the connections, who doesn't have the power that mainstream journalism journalists may have, but who seeks to protect all of our interests in what happens in our community and what happens in our government. Because she doesn't have the resources, because she doesn't have the connections, because she doesn't have the power, that's why she's sitting here. That's why she's sitting here saying to you, Judge, what do we do with this human being? Who we know was arrested, spent 8 hours in jail, had to go to the hospital because of the injuries that she received when she was arrested. She has been enlarged on bond and in the community, continuing to film, awarded and rewarded by those of her contemporaries for the last three years without any further incidents or problems. Sufficient punishment enough. I think that when we analyze what we are doing here, why we are doing it, and you say, what should we do with this human being? I think we say, okay, you spent 8 hours in jail. Okay, you've been brought before a court and tried by jury. You've been released into the community for 3 years. There is not a scintilla of evidence that she presents any type of danger to the community, risk of fleeing, any type of harm to the community. It's just the opposite. Everyone comes walking into this courtroom and says, thank you, Nydia Tisdale, for doing what you do. And this, I suggest to the court, is a monumental aberration in the life of Ms. Tisdale. You've heard from all sorts
of people in the community, from those who are in high-level journalism, from those who are in academia, from the sheriff of this community, from the elected sheriff of this community, whom Ms. Tisdale filmed her, his election party. I suggest to you, and I'm not going to belabor it because I'm not here to retry the case. The fact that she spent 8 hours is sufficient. The fact that she has been on bond for 3 years is sufficient. I suggest to the court that sentence alone, the fact that she is here, the fact that she has gone through this, is sufficient punishment for this particular person in these particular facts. First Amendment protections don't end with the spoken word. We're not here talking about the spoken word. We're talking here about the recorded word, about the word that can be disseminated by a new means of journalism. It's not so new anymore, but videos in the internet and blogging is a form of journalism that's well recognized now and will continue to be so even more in the future. What she does protects the public's right to access information about officials' public activities. And that is the core. That's at the core of our democratic society. So let's tell Nydia Tisdale that we respect what she does. We appreciate what she does. And that she has, because of the way this case has progressed, she has served what function, what punishment society deems to be appropriate to the offense for which the jury found her guilty. So I would request time served, no fine, because there are, everybody really connected with Ms. Tisdale has volunteered their services to help her in this particular matter. I think one of the articles that we submitted indicates that her total contribution to her activities and how don't even add up to $5,000 a year. So she makes no money doing this. She does it because, as everybody has told you, she is powerfully committed to what she does. And she provides service for everyone in this community and every other community. I also suggest to the court that she be granted, in your discretion, first offender treatment. We have spoken with her about what that means and what that is, and the upside and the downside, and especially using it in, it's unusual to see a first offender used in a misdemeanor, but there is, I can't imagine in my wildest dreams or other scenarios in which Ms. Tisdale would be brought before the bar, brought into court, hailed into court, and charged with an offense. It's just unimaginable to me, knowing her as I do for the 3 years that I've been involved in this case. So, time served, suspended sentence, or terminated, if you're going to do a fine, terminate the suspended sentence on payment of a fine. I think $1,000 is a lot of money, because with surcharges, it gets to be increasingly expensive, one. Two, she told you about how much your camera costs, and that the fine would be more than the camera that she uses would cost, and I think that would be a significant burden on her and her family finances. I think the idea of an apology, a letter of apology, I know better than to make noise when someone says something important. But I think that's ludicrous. I think it's ludicrous in the sense that it is Ms. Tisdale that went to the hospital. It is Ms. Tisdale that was injured. It is Mr. Wooten that allegedly was in the lawful performance of his duties. And I don't think that I've ever seen an apology letter from a law enforcement officer when my clients are acquitted, or they're abused, or they're beaten, or they're shot, or they're kicked, or their houses are ransacked. And to make that request in this particular instance of this particular person is, I think, beyond the pale. That's my request to the court. Thank you.
I'll take 10 minutes.
You have to do that for real quiet. She already has her own right up.
I'd be proud to be on your video.
There you go.
At this point, I wouldn't. Bill
wants some pictures. I'll send you some pictures.
Oh, I appreciate it. I'm scared to turn my phone on. I had it taken away once. I ain't doing that anymore.
He can turn it on in a month now.
You're right.
He threw his sucker off.
I'm not afraid of these county commission judges. I'm scared of death.
The station opened to McDonald's and tried to hijack the and then she pulled out the gun and shot him. And then a couple of good Samaritans and then we had an armed robbery at the food cart over on Dawson's. Stop bringing these people up here.
Come to order.
Ms. Tisdale, would you stand, please? Your attorney tells me you would like for me to sentence you under the First Offender Act. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you personally asking me to do that?
Yes, please.
Do you understand that that act has some good parts and some not so good parts?
Yes.
The good part of the act is that if I sentence you under the First Offender Act and you successfully complete all of the terms of your sentence, you will not have a record. You will not have a conviction for this misdemeanor. Do you understand that?
Yes, ma'am.
The not so good part is that if you violate any of the terms of the sentence, you can be brought before the court, you would be adjudicated guilty of obstruction of officer, and you could be sentenced, basically resentenced at that time, up to the maximum that was remaining on your sentence, and you could be sentenced to jail for that time. Do you understand that?
Yes, ma'am.
So you're asking that I sentence you under the First Offender Act? I will agree to sentence you under the First Offender Act since you have requested it, so I will not adjudicate you guilty, but as to count two, obstruction of officer, I sentence you to the following. I sentence you to 12 months in the Dawson County Jail to be served on probation. You will have a $1,000 fine plus add-ons required by law. You will report to misdemeanor probation, and you will pay a monthly probation fee. You will perform 40 hours of community service work as directed by probation. You are to have no contact with Tony Wooten, and you are not to go on the premises of Burt's Pumpkin Farm. You will have all the other regular conditions of probation. I am not ordering that you submit any letter of apology. Law enforcement officers do not ask for letters of apology. They are doing their job. They get spat upon, they get attacked, they get shot, they get threatened, and that is part of their job. They don't ask for apologies or thanks. It's all in a day's work for them. Without law enforcement officers, our First Amendment rights, our property rights, any of our rights would mean nothing. That is the sentence. Is there any clarification that anyone needs? Mr. Greer?
No, Judge. Thank you.
Mr. Harvey?
I don't need any clarification.
All right. Who does the sentence? You all will wait. The sentence will be signed. I do have to inform you, Ms. Tisdale, you have been convicted by a jury. You have now been sentenced. You have a right to appeal your conviction to a higher court. You also have a right to file a motion for new trial with this court. You must do so within 30 days because the sentence will be entered today. I'm sure that Mr. Harvey will inform you of that right. And if the motion for new trial is denied, you would have 30 days from that point to file a notice of appeal. If you have any complaints about your attorney or the way your case was handled, you also would need to bring that to the attention of the court. You may be seated. ordinance has been signed. You all are excused.
Thank you, Judge.
Let's get back to the calendar. I understand that the Miller case, you all want to put a settlement on the record? Okay. No, I think you can just submit it to the Judge Deal or whoever, whatever judge, because you don't need to go through trying to get it to me. You're not going to put it on the record. Yes, thank you. Appreciate you settling.
That is right.
It's still an interesting legal issue, isn't it?
On the Burt case, we can take more time to see if we can get a full settlement. I don't think we can be excused for a while after that.
Sounds great. I'll eat my apple.
Your Honor, on the final matter, Bennett versus Kirby, I still have not seen the defendant.
No, I think you can just submit it to the Judge Deal or whoever, whatever judge, because you don't need to go through trying to get it to me. Yes.
That's right.
Okay.
I was correct.
Sounds great, Ollie.
I'm ready.
She had to curl up her mouth.
Smart.
Misdemeanor probation.
Right.
How long does she have to pay the fine?
She has the whole year. You know, what they do is there'll be a bunch of state mandated add-ons. $100, and then they split it out through the course of the year, adding to it the probation and supervision fee. Probation is a big deal, and frankly, I'm a little surprised, you know, the judge took, you know, she went and took 20 minutes to just get to what they asked for.
So disappointed. I'm so disappointed with her, and there's that $35 a month monthly fee while she's on probation. Will that be precluded if the matter is appealed?
Well, so it is possible to stay a sentence during the pendency of an appeal. However, given the length of the appeal in this case, it'll take us a long time just to get the transcripts. I think it's probably going to be better to just deal with the first offender probation, get that out of the way, and then, you know, the appeal can also be dealt with. If there was any jail time, we would obviously try to stay the sentence immediately. So, but as it is, you know.
Do you mean go ahead and pay the fine, is that what you mean?
Right.
While pending appeal?
Right.
Okay. If you need help with that, I think there's a lot of us that want to contribute towards.
Well,
is it like a GoFundMe site?
You know, I think that GoFundMe does not let you set up stuff for criminal defense.
Okay.
But certainly.
Heck, I'll give it to you right now.
Not under their umbrella.
Well, yes.
Just.
Yes.
Yeah, how can we contribute?
Send David. David.
Just send it to Nydia.
Well, anything that you can put on Nydia has a PayPal, so you can always just send it to her directly on her PayPal.
Okay.
That's the easiest. She has a PayPal. So, all right, I'm going to go right into her probation.
Oh, okay. Find it where? I'm sorry.
Okay.
Sorry.
If nobody wants to volunteer, write that letter of apology.
Huh?
Nobody wants to volunteer, write that letter of apology.
No. No, I would never apologize for something.
No.
And what?
Please, both in between.
Would my middle finger suffice?
I'm sorry?
Would my middle finger suffice?
I'm just surprised it took as long as it did.
That was I think was a little bit uncalled for, to be honest with you.
Huh?
I think he went a little bit too far in there.
Oh, I know. It was all venom and vitriol. It was the most vile.
He was just
hatred.
I don't understand why district attorneys, all they see is punishment and taking your money. That's all they're saying.
It's control. It's control.
That's all it is control.
And you know what? You know, Nydia never could threat. I mean, I've seen.
What's not?
Honestly, I have no idea. Thank you. You got time to comment on the verdict?
Sure.
On the verdict or on, oh, on the excuse me, on the sentence? What are your thoughts about the sentence?
Well, I certainly hope that given Lydia's background, given the support she's got in the community, including the community of journalists who are in the mainstream media who understand that any threat to a journalist who provides information to the public about their public officials would certainly be treated differently than the ordinary misdemeanor, because this is a very standard sentence.
Do you plan to appeal the sentence?
Oh, it'll be appealed.
Okay.
Well, you don't necessarily appeal the sentence. The conviction will be appealed.
That's what I meant. Yeah.
And perhaps we'll have either another round or it'll go away.
Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Harvey.
Thank you.
Okay, don't.
I'm sorry?
It's a good day for the court.
Do you plan to appeal?
Well, you don't necessarily appeal the sentence, the conviction. And perhaps we'll have either another round or it'll go away.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Harvey.
Anything, everything goes wrong.
Okay.
All right. Or that the verdicts are inconsistent or otherwise mutually exclusive. Okay. So yes, there's always an advantage, but on the other hand, she is not convicted. She has no conviction. So if anybody, the President of the United States, comes up and says, I'd go with that. Let me go with another one. If anybody asked her on an employment application or any other kind of application or form, has she ever been convicted of anything? Her answer, in her truthful answer, is no, she has not.
And that becomes effective immediately, or at the conclusion of 1 year?
No. It's effective right now. What a first offender does is it withholds an adjudication of guilt.
Until the end of the...
If you do not successfully complete it, then an adjudication of guilt can be entered. Right now, putting her on first offender status means that an adjudication of guilt has not been entered, and therefore she can legitimately say, I have not been convicted of anything. If she fails in the year's worth of her probation, which I think, again, is you know, beyond peradventure that she's not going to, and if the judge, after a hearing, says, okay, I'm revoking your First Amendment status, I am going to enter an adjudication of guilt, then she is adjudicated guilty and she has a conviction. So right now she does not.
So there'd be nothing in a misdemeanor probation that would ban her from entering public buildings or require her to do a daily drug test or anything like that?
Absolutely not.
So no.
Thank you.
Everything goes wrong. Or that the verdicts are consistent or otherwise mutually exclusive, okay? So yes, there's always an advantage, but on the other hand, she is not convicted. She has no conviction. So if anybody, the President of the United States, comes up and says, I go with that. Let me go with another one. If anybody asked her on an employment application or any other kind of application or form, has she ever been convicted of anything? Her answer, in her truthful answer, is no, she has not.
And so that becomes effective immediately, or the conclusion of 1 year?
No. It's effective right now. What a first offender does is it withholds an adjudication of guilt.
Until the end of the...
If you do not successfully complete it, then an adjudication of guilt can be entered. Right now, putting her on first offender status means that an adjudication of guilt has not been entered, and therefore she can legitimately say, I have not been convicted of anything. If she fails in the year's worth of her probation, which I think, again, is you know, beyond peradventure that she's not going to, and if the judge, after a hearing, says, okay, I'm revoking your First Amendment status, I am going to enter an adjudication of guilt, then she is adjudicated guilty and she has a conviction. So right now she does not.
So there'd be nothing in a misdemeanor probation that would ban her from entering public buildings or require her to do a daily drug test or anything like that?
Absolutely not.
Is there a possibility that the sentence could be set aside in light of appeal?
Well, if her conviction gets set aside, yes. Her sentence is not going to get set aside if the conviction is not set aside.
So how does this do with the civil suit? So this sounds like the first offense.
Well, you'll have to ask the civil lawyer for that. Because I don't know. No, I know nothing about it.
If she were to appeal and get a new trial, is the new trial for all three of the original charges?
No.
Only for the charge she was convicted? Okay, because everyone's asking that.
Okay.
She's
got acquitted of that. That doesn't
go
well. The appeal will appeal the conviction and the conviction only, and whatever the judge's rulings and issues related to that particular.
Is there any technical grounds for that appeal?
Well, there are always technical grounds. You know, you can always say everything that happened is bullshit. Right? That's the technical.
Thank you. Journalists attending events?
Well, you know something, I think it will. I think it will, and that was my argument to the judge, that, you know something, he says it's not a First Amendment case, but it is. It may not be, but it really is. She is sitting doing nothing and doing something that really is at the core of the First Amendment, filming public officials at a public event. Okay, so I do think that journalists at large can learn a lesson, and it does impact them, because there is a distinction between private property and public property. You saw our president, and his name will not grace my lips, but they kicked people out of public events during the campaign, and they can do that, okay? But does it chill a journalist's ability to go into a public event? Are they thinking, am I gonna have to get permission every time I go in? Even to a public event that's publicly advertised, and everybody, every citizen of the United States of America, non-citizens, every human being alive is invited. Begs its own question.
Do you see it as a public accommodations question under the ADA?
Do I see it? No. I do not.
Is there a possibility that the sentence could be set aside in light of appeal?
Well, if her conviction gets set aside, yes. Her sentence is not going to get set aside if the conviction is not set aside.
So how does this do with the sentence? So this sounds like the first offense.
Well, you'll have to ask the civil lawyer. Because I don't know. No. I don't know. nothing about it.
If she were to appeal and get a new trial, is there a new trial for all three of the original charges?
No.
Only for the charge she was convicted? Okay, because everyone was asking that.
Yeah, no.
That seems okay.
She's got acquitted of that. That doesn't
Those are gone.
The appeal will appeal the conviction and the conviction only, and whatever the judge's rulings and issues related to that particular.
And is there any technical grounds for that appeal?
Well, there are always technical grounds. You know, you can always say everything that happened is bullshit. Right? That's the technical.
Thank you.
Well, you know something, I think it will. I think it will, and that was my argument to the judge, that, you know something, he says it's not a First Amendment case, but it is. It may not be, but it really is. She is sitting doing nothing and doing something that really is at the core of the First Amendment, filming public officials at a public event. Okay, so I do think that journalists at large can learn a lesson, and it does impact them, because there is a distinction between private property and public property. You saw our president, and his name will not grace my lips, but they kicked people out of public events during the campaign, and they can do that, okay? But does it chill a journalist's ability to go into a public event? Are they thinking, am I gonna have to get permission every time I go in? Even to a public event that's publicly advertised, and everybody, every citizen of the United States of America, non-citizens, every human being alive is invited.
Do you see it as a public accommodations question under the ADA?
Do I see it? No. I do not.
How does Nydia's Fourth Amendment come into play with her being on probation?
Well, that may be a condition, but I'm unsure of that. This is not a drug case. It's not a case in which that would be or should be an issue. It's a misdemeanor conviction. It's not a misdemeanor conviction that, if it is a conviction, that would impact even as a first offender, her Second Amendment rights, for example, her right to vote, for example, or any other of the core amendments going forward. So I don't know whether a Fourth Amendment waiver is part of the standard conditions of probation for this offense. Mm-hmm. Shouldn't be. It has nothing to do with it.
So Bruce, is there any rights she loses while she's doing this probation thing every little next
well,
year?
Well, yeah, yes, of course. For example, I think that one of the standard conditions is you gotta get permission to travel out of state, mm-hmm. or you gotta get permission to go somewhere. That's a core value, your right to travel, your right to go places, and in certain instances, your right to have contact with certain other people is limited as well. You know, she's prohibited from going to Burt's farm, for example, which she would otherwise have a right to do. She's prohibited from going around Tony Luton, which otherwise she'd have a right to do. If you're on probation, there are certain limitations to your rights. Are they debilitating in a certain sense? In this instance, for a misdemeanor, no.
So she's even going to have to ask permission to go visit her mother?
Yes.
Yes. Is that done through her probation officer?
Yes. Yeah, and I don't believe that's going to be denied under any set of circumstances. It's just another hoop you have to go through in order to go through this. I mean, look, she has been on bond for 3 years with the same kind of limitations and structure and oversight by the criminal justice system. What's the purpose of doing it for another year? I truly don't understand that.
How do you feel this affects the right of especially us females to defend ourselves against an ununiformed officer when we feel our safety being threatened?
Well,
I'm very concerned about that.
Act first and worry about the consequences later.
We see the consequences.
Well, you know, there's an old saying, I'd rather be judged by 12 than carried by 6, right?
Do you think this may have been a case of circling the wagons to stop a civil lawsuit?
Yes. Yes, I think they are inexorably linked. Right. Yes, I do.
Honestly, me too.
Yeah, well,
we all do.
You just asked me and I said yeah. So there you have it.
How does Nydia's Fourth Amendment come into play with her being on probation?
Well, that may be a condition, but I'm unsure of that. This is not a drug case. It's not a case in which that would be or should be an issue. It's a misdemeanor conviction. It's not a misdemeanor conviction that, if it is a conviction, that would impact even as a first offender her Second Amendment rights, for example, her right to vote, for example, or any other of the core amendments going forward. So I don't know whether a Fourth Amendment waiver is part of the standard conditions of probation for this offense. It shouldn't be. It has nothing to do with it.
Mr. Bruce, is there any right she loses while she's doing this probation thing?
Yes, of course. For example, I think that one of the standard conditions is you got to get permission to travel out of state, or you got to get permission to go somewhere. That's a core value. Your right to travel, your right to go places, and in certain instances, your right to have contact with certain other people is limited as well. You know, she's prohibited from going to Burt's farm, for example, which she would otherwise have a right to do. She's prohibited from going around Tony, which otherwise she'd have a right to do. If you're on probation, there are certain limitations to your rights. Are they debilitating in a certain sense? In this instance, for a misdemeanor, no.
So she's even going to have to ask permission to go visit her mother?
Yes. Yes.
Is that done through her probation office?
Yes. Yeah, and I don't believe that's going to be denied under any set of circumstances.
Yeah.
It's just another hoop you have to go through in order to go through this. I mean, look, she has been on bond for 3 years with the same kind of limitations and structure and oversight by the criminal justice system. What's the purpose of doing it for another year? I truly don't understand that.
How do you feel this affects the right of, especially us females, to defend ourselves against an ununiformed officer when we feel our safety being threatened?
Well,
I'm very concerned about that.
I act first and worry about the consequences later.
We see the consequences.
Well, you know, there's an old saying, I'd rather be judged by 12 than carried by 6.
This may have been a case of circling the wagons to stop a civil lawsuit.
I think they are inexorably linked.
Very good.
Yes, I do.
Honestly, me too.
Yeah, well,
we all do.
You just asked me and I said yeah. So there you have it.
What has surprised you the most about the case overall?
What surprised? Okay, I can tell you what surprised me the most, that we're actually here talking about it. Right? I mean, I truly believe that in most, if not all, other places, that this would never have been indicted, it never would have been prosecuted. People would sit down and say, come on, look, this is what we were doing, this is how we should handle these situations. Thank you, let's do better next time. To take it to a grand jury to indict it for a felony, and we've been here 7 days, this is our seventh day of this trial, 3 years later.
Was there a statute of limitations running on them to have to have taken it to the grand jury for something that happened like
4 years?
It's 4 years.
It's 4 years for a felon.
Is it up to the owner of a property, as in this case, to say, no, you cannot perform this act?
To say that directly to the person.
So that's
No, it doesn't have to be him.
Oh, it doesn't have to be him.
It can be an authorized representative as long as they identify themselves appropriately and tell them. I mean, even a cop can do it. That's why Conley Greer and the state can stand up and say, this is not a First Amendment case.
Right.
And that's why he argued, you know, this is a case that involves the tension between the rights of private property owners and a public political event. And I think there is a considerable amount of tension between those two positions, but at the end of the day, yes, a private property owner, as long as they do it the right way, has the right to say, you know something, I don't like your socks. Those are ugly socks. They go with an ugly Christmas sweater, and I don't want those ugly socks on my property, and you get to leave. Now, you can't do it for a protected reason. Can't do it for if it's a public place, or even if it's a private place. Race, sex, other reasons like that, constitutionally protected rights. But otherwise, yes.
Well, that sounds like that would apply to First Amendment.
No.
What has surprised you the most about the case overall?
I can tell you what surprised me the most, that we're actually here talking about it.
Yeah.
I mean. I truly believe that in most, if not all, other places, that this would never have been indicted. It never would have been prosecuted. People would sit down and say, come on, look, this is what we were doing. This is how we should handle these situations. Thank you. Let's do better next time. To take it to a grand jury to indict it for a felony, and we've been here 7 days, this is our seventh day of this trial, 3 years later.
Was there a statute of limitations running on them to have to have taken it to the grand jury for something that happened like
4 years?
It's 4 years.
Yeah, it's 4 years for a felon.
For a felon, yeah.
So, it's...
Is it up to the owner of a property, as in this case, to say, no, you cannot perform this act?
To say that directly to the person.
So that's,
No, it doesn't have to be him.
Oh, it doesn't have to be him.
It can be an authorized representative as long as they identify themselves appropriately and tell them. I mean, even a cop can do it. That's why Conley Greer and the state can stand up and say, this is not a First Amendment case.
Right.
And that's why he argued, you know, this is a case that involves the tension between the rights of private property owners and a public political event. And I think there is a considerable amount of tension between those two positions. At the end of the day, yes, a private property owner, as long as they do it the right way, has the right to say, you know something, I don't like your socks. Those are ugly socks. They go with an ugly Christmas sweater, and I don't want those ugly socks on my property, and you get to leave. Now, you can't do it for a protected reason. You can't do it for, if it's a public place, or even if it's a private place. Race, sex, other reasons like that, constitutionally protected rights. But otherwise, yes.
Well, that sounds like that would apply to First Amendment.
No, no.
Do you think there might be a question of actual apparent and implied authority somehow missing as a potential for appeal? I mean, the guy came up from behind her.
No, hold on, hold on. She got acquitted, right, of criminal trespass. That's what requires the notice.
Oh, gotcha.
She got acquitted of felony obstruction, which requires an injury to the person. Some physical contact, both of which you understand relied solely on the testimony of Burt. Okay, so the events that were not either captured on video or corroborated by some other individual, she got acquitted of. Okay? The event for which she got convicted, there were photographs, there was the video, there was the post arrest video and oral content. So, I forgot your question. No.
That charge did not require actual apparent or implied authority or
an actual
crime? So no crime had to be committed for her to be convicted of obstruction?
That's correct. You're absolutely correct.
It seems so obvious.
Because there is a difference. If you think you have, then you might have probable cause to arrest someone. And someone resists, okay? Having probable cause doesn't mean you're going to get convicted. You can get acquitted because a jury doesn't believe that you have proof beyond a reasonable doubt. The standards are two different standards. So you can get acquitted of the offense, but still convicted of obstruction.
I think the key thing is that she didn't know it was an officer.
If
she knew he was an officer.
Okay, but that's exactly what the jury...
Awesome, I know.
Okay, so and therein lies, I think, the inconsistency. What is, you have to know that it's an officer to resist or an authorized. He came up and said...
Like a professor.
He testified, I'm Tony Wooten, I'm with the sheriff's office, I'm authorized to tell you to leave or stop filming.
Thank you for your words.
That's the same thing as is required for her to knowingly and willfully resist orders of a law enforcement officer. But again, if you look at it this way, they acquitted her of every incident, of both the incidents, which relied entirely on the court. So,
do you think there might be a question of actual apparent and implied authority somehow missing as a potential for appeal? I mean, the guy came up from behind her.
No, hold on. She got acquitted, right, of criminal trespass. That's what requires the notice.
Oh, gotcha.
She got acquitted of felony obstruction, which requires an injury to the person, some physical contact, both of which you understand relied solely on the testimony of Burt. Okay, so the events that were not either captured on video or corroborated by some other individual, she got acquitted of. Okay, the event for which she got convicted, there were photographs, there was the video, there was the post arrest video and oral content. So, I forgot your question.
No. But.
That charge did not require actual apparent or implied authority or.
Well, would you say that?
So no crimes had to be committed for her to be convicted of obstruction.
That's correct. You're absolutely correct.
Because seems so obvious.
Because there is a difference. If you think you have, and you might have, probable cause to arrest someone, and someone resists, okay? Having probable cause doesn't mean you're going to get convicted. You can get acquitted because a jury doesn't believe that you have proof beyond a reasonable doubt. The standards are two different standards. So you can get acquitted of the offense, but still convicted of obstruction.
I think the key thing is that she didn't know it was an officer.
Just make sure she was resisting.
Well, that's, but.
If she knew he was an officer.
Okay, but that's exactly what the jury.
Just let me know.
Okay, so and therein lies, I think, the inconsistency. One is, you have to know that it's an officer to resist or an authorized. He came up and said, and he testified, I'm Tony Wooten, I'm with the sheriff's office, I'm authorized to tell you to leave or stop filming and leave. That's the same thing as is required for her to knowingly and willfully resist orders of a law enforcement officer. But again, if you look at it this way, they acquitted her of every incident, of both the incidents, which relied entirely on his order.
So,
Georgia law only requires four.
It's right there. Good, okay.
All
right, you know. All right, welcome, thank you, good question.
You're welcome.
Thank you. All right. Thank you for your
closing. See
you. Thanks, guys.
Georgia law only requires four.
It's right there. Good, okay.
All
right, you know. All right, you're welcome, thank you, good question.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you for your closing.
See you.
Thanks, Bruce.
See y'all. I'm going to go up on Monday tomorrow.
She was sick because she had a lot of
We'll see how it.
That judge was way out of line in that comment. Way out of line.
I think it shows a bias.
Sure does. Absolutely. It's the whole thing, just everything.
It was a shit show. The railroad.
She completely mirrored exactly what he said. Didn't deviate from the first section at all. Which, it's like, really? Really? I mean, like, you're this. None of this has made any. I mean, I'm almost kind of glad I wasn't here.
This is right for a dystopian novel, don't you think?
Mm-hmm. Right, they have to. They have to do what the government says you have to do.
We'll see how it turns out. But I mean, everybody being here was huge. I can't believe that with everybody here, it still did not make a difference in the sentence. That was what he asked for, was 12 months of probation and the maximum fine. So, except the apology, which really was ridiculous. I mean, certainly being on probation is dangerous in that situation. I can't give you a ride to the mall. I can give you a ride to the alley.
That's what my wife
is. So she's not in a lot more danger of that than she would be otherwise. That's what the committee is committed to, public accountability and transparency. And so in this case, hopefully it's bringing attention. Well, and so we should probably head down to that because I'm going to get a ride over the alley. So I think let's go talk to Mike Pacheco.
I wanted to show this photo. This is when I met Catherine for the first time. This is Catherine. Uh-huh. And this is me, obviously, I'm holding the sign. This was in the Brookhaven area. That's why I was, when I saw that, you know, I was supposed to write a letter to send it to her, I was like, well, that's Catherine. I sent it to her, but it might have been too late. So, you know, she wanted to see if I could make it today. And then that's why I met her for the first time, you know.
One, please.
So.
We're going to come more guys.
Channel 2 is downstairs outside, and he wants to talk to the eyes of all of you.
Did y'all hear that?
Channel 2.
Nydia would like all of us to stand beside. For the interview.
So let's all kind of second together for this interview.
I was wondering why was it half that?
Just gonna spend Christmas money. I'm gonna spend all the money I made on the Tisdale.
What's the name of it?
Audit Recon.
Able to
to upload your video to your website.
The one that I've got here, probably a couple, 3 hours.
Okay.
But this one is Nydia's, so it may be a little while longer.
That's your camera?
Yep.
Oh, awesome.
I think this is the camera that was assault. She was assaulted by.
Did you actually know? Was anything served on our newsroom? Did you get proper service?
Maybe serve you in your official capacity.
This is bullshit.
Did they say tag, you're it?
All right. Well, we'll start with Nydia. All right. We know your name. Please tell us.
Nydia Tisdale.
Ms. Tisdale, your reaction to the judge's sentence?
It's disappointing that I didn't get a sentence of time served. I had spent 8 hours in the detention center in the jail here in Dawson County, and I thought that was more than sufficient punishment for the verdict that was rendered by the jury.
What has the situation been like for you?
Well, for the last 3 years and almost 5 months now, it's really taken a toll on me because I feel like my life is under arrest. I have to respond to felony calls, and I don't know when they might be. So, to do anything, I can't commit to going or doing anything. And now, probation somewhat extends that commitment of my time and not really being able to be in control of my movements, including fringes on the things.
For the judge to say, for the prosecutor to say that this case was not about the First Amendment, how do you respond?
I understand property rights and property ownership. I respect that, but it is most certainly a First Amendment.
Channel 2 provides the best witnesses when we need them. Yeah. All we do is we need witnesses. We call Channel 2.
My calling you says, I think, is what he's referred to himself.
And we say, hey, we need witnesses. And he says, what do you want me to say?
Yeah, the look on my face, I think, probably said it all. What, me? Looking at me?
Yeah, it did. It really did. And I leaned over and said,
Nydia says,
now you know. She literally
was anything
said,
served on our newsroom? I don't know. It was a proper service.
You got no service. I was
did we serve you in your official capacity?
Yeah, exactly.
This is question. This is bullshit.
Did they say tag, you're it?
All right. Well, we'll start with Nydia. We know your name, but please tell us.
Nydia Tisdale.
Ms. Tisdale, your reaction to the judge's sentence?
It's disappointing that I didn't get a sentence of time served. I had spent 8 hours in the detention center in the jail here in Dawson County, and I thought that was more than sufficient punishment for the verdict that was rendered by the jury.
What has the situation been like for you?
Well, for the last 3 years and almost 5 months now, it's really taken a toll on me because I feel like my life is under arrest. I have to respond to all the calls and I don't know when they might be. So, to go anywhere and do anything, and now with probation, somewhat extends that commitment to be in control of my.
For the judge to say, for the prosecutor to say that this case was not about the First Amendment, how do you respond?
I understand property rights and property ownership. I respect that, but it is most certainly a First Amendment.
You know, witnesses aren't supposed to have phones or microphones.
Apparently not. Yeah.
They didn't take the pink dollars or
whatever. Yeah.
Back to the question of the prosecutor saying this was not about the First Amendment.
Oh, I think it certainly involves the First Amendment. Our First Amendment freedoms, the right of
of free speech and free press, and to gather the news as it's happening for the benefit of the public and our citizens and our voters. We need to know what our officials are doing at a public rally that was advertised as open to the public in the legal organ, in the local newspaper, and on social media, online, on the internet. So I think most certainly it was a First Amendment issue, although I wasn't being charged with filming. I was being charged with criminal trespass. However, I never heard the word criminal trespass until I was actually in a jail cell, and when Mr. Wooten arrived and read the charges to me. No one had announced to me that I was being trespassed off the property. No one had asked me to leave the property, so it's very confusing to me.
Will this deter you from doing what you do?
No, and I continue doing what I do, which is filming public meetings of public interest, and it slowed me down a little bit, but I still enjoy video recording, yes.
At what point does it not become worth it? Or does that ever happen?
Does what not become worth
it? Doing what you do, going to events and recording them. Is there a point where it's not worth it to you?
She's been under the jurisdiction of the court for 3 years and continued to do that. And it's important work. It's important work like you do. So I don't think there's a point at which she gets deterred. You know, she had a choice. She had a choice not to take this to a jury. But she made, I think, a very courageous choice in saying, you know, I want my day improved. So I hope it doesn't chill journalists like yourself. It certainly hasn't deterred Nydia, because she has the same kind of commitment you and your fellow journalists have.
Do you appeal?
Yes.
All.
Well, not half of it.
In other words, you appeal the conviction.
Yes, of course.
And then which would nullify everything else.
Yes.
Okay. How quick of a process is that?
It's a slow process. It is always a slow process. Even for this case, you know, we've been here, this is our seventh day here for a misdemeanor first offender. You're not convicted. I'm standing up for my rights case. So it'll take some 3 years down the road. So it'll take another 12 to 16 to 18 months.
I've seen some comments made about this being, you know, a miscarriage of justice that even got to this point. We even had a trial. What do you think about it?
Ditto.
Nydia, what are your thoughts on that?
I think the fact that I was even arrested is just an egregious overreach by the officer.
Don't you think there are better ways to handle this? Don't you think that there are ways that we can resolve private property and First Amendment issues in a better way than with a felony criminal prosecution? I mean, aren't we beyond that at this particular point? I think we are, and I hope that everybody can learn from this experience at the expense of Nydia, who stood up and made the decision to go forward with the case. But yes, why are we here? Why should we be here?
What does this do to your civil case? Is it still on hold?
Ask the civil lawyers. I mean, really, because we don't.
Well, but you put things...
It was stayed pending the outcome of this criminal case, and so I need to consult with them and find out what happens next. But I imagine it will continue to stay during the process.
Is there anything else you want to add?
Thank you for covering my trial, my lieutenant. I appreciate the media giving attention to this very important First Amendment issue.
Yeah, nice job as a witness. We got the video if you want.
I'm good. I appreciate it. Thanks very much. All right. Thank you. All right.
I got the video.
Yes.
That's great.
Thanks, Michael.
That was a great way to end it. Thanks, man.
Hey, appreciate it, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks for all your help.
Great to meet you.
You too. Keep in touch.
I'll take care.
All right, I'm going to end this one.
Oh, I think it certainly involves the First Amendment. Our First Amendment freedoms to write of free speech and free press, and to gather the news as it's happening for the benefit of the public and our citizens and our voters. We need to know what our officials are doing at a public rally that was advertised as open to the public in the legal organ, in the local newspaper, and on social media, online on the internet. So I think most certainly it was a First Amendment issue, although I wasn't being charged with filming, I was being charged with criminal trespass. However, I never heard the word criminal trespass until I was actually in a jail cell, and when Mr. Wooten arrived and read the charges to me, no one had announced to me that I was being trespassed off the property. No one had asked me to leave the property, so it's very confusing to me.
Will this deter you from doing what you do?
No, and I continue doing what I do, which is filming public meetings and public interest. It slowed me down a little bit, but I still enjoy video recording, yes.
At what point does it not become worth it? Or does that ever happen?
Does what not become worth it?
Doing what you do, going to events and recording them. Is there a point where it's not worth it to you?
She's been under the jurisdiction of the court for 3 years and continued to do that. And it's important work. It's an important work like you do. So I don't think there's a point at which she gets deterred. You know, she had a choice. She had a choice not to take this to her. But she made, I think, a very courageous choice in saying, you know, I want my name. I hope it doesn't chill journalists like yourself. It certainly hasn't deterred Nydia, because she has the same kind of commitment you and your fellow journalists have.
Do you appeal?
Yes, certainly.
All of
it? Well, not half of it.
In other words, you appeal the conviction.
Yes, of course.
And then
yes.
which would nullify everything else.
Yes.
How quick of a process is that?
It's a slow process. It is always a slow process. Even for this case, you know, we've been here this is our seventh day here for a misdemeanor first offender. You're not convicted. I'm standing up for my rights case. So it'll take some 3 years down the road. So it'll take another 12 to 16 or 18 months.
I've seen some comments made about this being a miscarriage of justice that even got to this point and had a trial. Nydia, what are your thoughts on that?
I think the fact that I was even arrested, it was just an egregious overreach by the officer.
Don't you think there are better ways to handle this? Don't you think that there are ways that we can resolve private property and First Amendment issues in a better way than with a felony criminal prosecution? I mean, aren't we beyond that at this particular point? I think we are, and I hope that everybody can learn from this experience at the expense of Nydia, who stood up and made the decision to go forward with the case. But yes, why are we here? Why should we be here?
What does this do to your civil case? Is it still on hold?
Ask the civil lawyers. because we don't.
Well, but you put things.
It was stayed pending the outcome of this criminal case, and so I need to consult with them and find out what happens next. But I imagine that we're keeping it during that process.
Is there anything else you want to add?
Thank you for covering the trial. I appreciate the media giving attention to this very important First Amendment issue.
And nice job as a witness. We got the video if you want.
Okay. We'll put it in. Appreciate it. Thanks very much. All right. Thank you.
All right, Catherine.
Yes. To the outlet.
Okay.
Thanks, Mike.
Oh, we got to go.
No worries.
Hey, appreciate it, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks for all your help. Thank you. You too. Keep it tight.
Hey, Dad.
I don't know if you want the building behind or
she
have a good
steel
eye.
Picture. You need to get them.
Come on, freedom fighters.
Yeah, I will.
Yeah.
Any white doves today?
This is good.
Where's your camera?
Right here.
All right, I'm fine, right?
Okay.
Got two phones.
Very good. Thank you.
All right.
There you have
it. Souvenir photos. Always.
Send me the postcard.
James.
Thanks, buddy.
Nice to meet you.
Hey. How about if you snap on with Ben? Can you snap on with me and Ben?
Yeah, absolutely.
I think it was a case of clear abusive process.
Thanks again.
Have a great one.
You too. Thank you.
Safe travels.
You going out to lunch or anything?
Oh, I think, I'm not, probably, but there's a place where I don't know if it's a school barbecue place. Right.
All right.
Buddy.
Yes, I got there about 15 minutes after kickoff. How long?